Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om Sthapakaya cha Dharmasya Sarvadharma Swarupine Avatar Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha.
We have been going through this slender volume of Ishavasya Upanishad for nearly a year plus, and now we have come towards the last part of our study. We have almost reached the end of the 18 verses long Upanishad. Though it is one of the smallest Upanishads, it is the most profound and also widely read Upanishad. In just these 18 verses, we find so much of wisdom, so much of insight into life, into ultimate reality, into what a man ultimately seeks has been put. The Upanishads are like that. They are not sectarian. They are not meant just for one set of people, but they are so universal in their appeal, in their message. And what they preach is essentially how a person can attain the purpose of his life. The purpose of life, is it outside ourselves or is it right within ourselves? Generally, the purpose of life is one question which every thinking person gets once in a while. What is the purpose of life? Why we are living? What's the purpose of all our activities? All our actions done in different ways? Why we do certain things and why we do not do certain things? What restricts us? What propels us? This line of thinking about purpose of life, ultimately gets answered by the term self-realization. That a person has to ultimately know what he is. It is the idea of self which propels us to do what we are doing. For example, a policeman, a police constable in the traffic management, he does his duty as a policeman because he thinks he is a policeman. If that self-image or self-idea that I am a policeman was not there, he would not be going and standing and doing this work. Whatever we do, therefore, there is an image behind that of what we think of the self. So we think we are this limited being, so we need something to make it full. This limited personality that we have, full of imperfections, full of absences, There are so many things which are absent. Look at a person who is very poor. In his case, money is absent. He is seeking money. A person who is sick, health is absent. A person who is full of a dark, gloomy idea of life, happiness is absent. There are so many ways we can see this kind of absence taking place. Or that absence, that idea of absence or leading, or that we are missing something, incompleteness. It makes people search for so many things. They search in money, they search in fame, in name, in properties, in what not. The whole of life, people are searching. Searching to remove their wants. So certain goals, the collective living puts it before them, that if you have this, you will feel very full. But that, does it really make them full? That they have to themselves find out. And in the Upanishads, in one of the other Upanishads, we find, as long as man does not know the self, he cannot become fulfilled. If a person was to become fulfilled without knowing the self, it would be like rolling up the whole sky like a piece of cloth. You cannot roll the sky as a piece of cloth. Likewise, you cannot become totally satisfied or free from all restlessnesses and all kinds of what we lack until you know the self. This knowledge of the self has been kept as the goal of life, ultimate goal of life. Of course, there are relative goals, what we call as the Dharma Shastras. Dharma Shastras have tried to work it out by way of dividing our duties based on our age, our capacities, and so many things. And these Dharma Shastras injunctions keep changing. What Swamiji used to say, they are smritis, and smritis keep changing. What was relevant, what to speak of 100 years back, what was relevant even 10 years back, may not be relevant today. It may change. So that change should represent that quest, the quest for ultimate satisfaction, ultimate sense of peace. So we find this journey in the Upanishad. The Upanishad begins with saying that try to cover everything with God. Ishavasya vidam sarvam. And he says, ma kasya, do not try to take away others' property, or do not have any greedy outlook. He says, the Upanishad begins by saying that enjoy by renouncing things. That was one statement which impressed many great thinkers. In many of his writings, Mahatma Gandhi mentions this statement of Ishavasya Upanishad. He says, what a deep statement. Enjoy through renouncing things. Generally people, when they speak of renunciation, they speak of renunciation of happiness. They don't think renunciation could mean that it's joy. But that is what the Upanishad is trying to say or remind us, that we have to seek happiness through giving up the small. Bhumaiva sukham nalpam sukham asti. So this journey began with that joy is not to be found in small but in the big. Externally, if you look at religion or religious ideas or religious institutions or religious practices in general, it has got one look. Immediately it brings to our mind temples, rituals, festivals, certain holy men and women, certain things which we call as religion. Prasada, flowers, garlands, arati, or if you are not into this path. You have the other paths. There you find different images. You go to church, or you go to a mosque, or you go to some other religious place. So that kind of idea comes. Religion means I go to these places. I follow what most of these their books seem to say, or their holy men seem to say. That is an external view of the religion. And in that view, there is so much of also differences. There are differences of opinion, differences of expression. But if you enter the very core of religion, and that core is, religion is a path for self-fulfillment, self-transformation, for self-change. If you go or approach religion through this, you find a different meaning. And that is the true meaning which religion is, in which is to be seen or to be understood. So you find this in the Upanishad, this approach, the internal approach. It tries to tell us how you can change yourself. It begins by saying that become, first of all, a seeker for the self, not seeker of money, not seeker of fame or anything that the world can give us. That kind of seekers are what we call as worldly people. They just go for it. For them the world is so real, so they run for that. What is the definition of real? One of our very senior monks used to say that real is that which attracts all our attention, all our feelings, all our thoughts. For some people, that is very, very, any something is very real for time being. For time being, what is real, it will attract all our attention, all our feelings, all our thoughts. But it will shift. What sounds very real may not be so much real after some time. For a child, his toy is broken. He weeps because for him, toy is real. And the loss of toy is actually loss of the real. And he weeps for that. But soon he grows up. But does he really grow up? Of course, externally he grows up. He doesn't weep for toy. But when he grows up, he weeps for something bigger. He calls it car. He calls it property. He weeps for that. He has grown up in one sense, but has he really grown? He weeps for, I am not that popular. Or he weeps for that somebody else is more popular. Even that's more problematic. So, this growth has to come. Growth of what we consider as real. It's a journey. From Swami Vivekananda used to has in his beautiful word, he says, it's a journey from lower truth to higher truth. It is a lower truth, and then we have to proceed to the higher truth. It's not a journey from error to truth, but from truth to truth, from lower joy, if you might call it like that, from lower joy to higher joy. From lower reality to higher reality. This journey is what we call as religious life or spiritual life. Spiritual life is not just external rituals, but when these rituals are connected with an internal reality or internal seeking, then they become meaningful. Otherwise, meaninglessly people go on. They are lost in some ritual without knowing the purpose for which they are doing it. So we find this Upanishad beginning with this, asking us to become a seeker. Ishavasya midam sarvam, which means become a seeker, cover everything with God. Try to divinize your life. In your relationships with others, try to see divinity in others. Well, it's quite all right to say that I will see divinity in others. Problem comes when we have to deal with difficult people. people who are very difficult to handle, how do we see divinity in them? And Sri Ramakrishna's advice comes to hand, and he says, there is God in all, but in some people, God is to be made namaskars from a distance. Like Bhaga Narayana. There are some who are like lions. So lion also has got God in him, but you don't go and embrace it. You say, very good, there is God in him, from a distance I make namaskars to him. That's the extreme case. But there are other ways, but there is still, he recognizes, there is God in all. Even in the most hopeless of men, we must recognize the divinity. Because, now that depends on first faith of what the scriptures are telling, or faith in what the sages are telling. After so much austerity, Swami Vivekananda says in one place, I have understood one thing, and that is, man is nothing but God himself. That there is divinity in all. After so much of austerity, this is the truth that he found. But, do we have faith in the truth that he has found? So let's have faith in that. Or, you yourself do the austerity and attain to that. You yourself find out by your efforts what he has found, or what countless sages down the ages have found it. Countless. Some are known, well known, some are not at all known. They silently pass away. They silently know the truth. They practice it. They are not bothered whether somebody speaks about them. They are not bothered whether anybody writes about them. They just live it. And in that living is a blessing for this world. So first thing is, the Upanishad says, have that. And then we find this journey where he says, you try to overcome your vidya, avidya. And then he speaks of so many other aspects. And then also he try to see the oneness in all. And the famous statement, tatrako moha kashoka ekattvam anupashyata. One who sees oneness. Where is shoka? Where is moha for him? Shoka comes when there is a division. What is this division? What divides? According to Vedantic tradition, the dividing principle or the principle of separation is called ego. What separates one from the other is ego. I am different. The moment you say I, you are different. The moment you say we, you are proceeding towards oneness. The moment you say I, you are speaking of all the whole host of your personal likes and dislikes, your upbringing, your education, your view of life. I has come into picture. But this journey, when it takes place, then finally what happens? A person proceeds towards, as we read in the last verse, he has reached a stage where he is coming in touch face to face with the reality. And he is praying, Hiranmayena Patrena. O Lord, you have covered yourself with Hiranmaya Patrena, Satyasyapihitam Mukham, Tattvam Pushanna Pavrano Satyadharmaya Drishtaye. You are as if covered yourself with a golden disc. Your face, your mouth, as if is covered with that. Please remove it. Now what is this? That God should cover himself with a golden disc. Why should he not cover himself with some other disc? Of course we know that we should remove impurities of mind. The mind has to be made pure to see God. It's not that the God is not there. He is right now present here. But we not see it, because the mind which is seeing through the eyes, the mind which is perceiving, having this experience through the senses, that mind has in it innumerable desires, innumerable samskaras and vasanas, which does not let the mind see the reality. Mind sees what already it is programmed to see. It is programmed by its, what is called in Vedanta as adhyasa. He has been programmed by a kind of delusion that this is real. And that is why it attracts all his attention. The mind is fully focused to that. And he cares for it, he works for it. He works hard to acquire, and if he does not get it, he suffers. See, they say there are only two reasons for unhappiness. One is not getting what you want. That's the first reason. And second is getting what you do not want. There's another reason for happiness, unhappiness. There are only two reasons. You take all the reasons in the world, you will find they fall into these two categories. You want something, you do not get it, you are unhappy. Or you get something which you did not want, that's why you are unhappy. There are no other reasons. So, that is again, why do I want this? Because I have been programmed like that. I have been in that such a state. Remember Alexander's story when he came to India, and when he was leaving, somebody said, India is a land of rishis. You should meet one of them before you leave. And he searched and he found one rishi somewhere in the jungle lying on a piece of stone, big rock near the river. And Alexander is impressed by his great sense of joy. He doesn't own anything, but he seems very happy, full of happiness. So he invited him, or rather he felt that he should possess him. He said, come, I'll take you to my kingdom. There we have a big palace. I'll give you a big palace to live and provide you all the amenities that you want. In today's word, you might say, I'll take you to a place where there's a beautiful apartment facing the seafront with all the modern amenities and close by mall. Everything is available, don't worry. Petrol also is very cheap there. But of course, this sage was not interested. He said, I'm quite happy here. This provides all my needs. What more you will fulfill? Whenever I feel hungry, I go to the jungle and take fruits. If I feel thirsty, I take water. He was very blessed, you see. There's good water. Yeah, just drink water. And if it rains, I go to the cave. And I cover with this tree bark. I don't need anything from you. Now, Alexander was shocked. He thought his list of amenities would attract him. So it hurt his ego and immediately shouted and said, what, you won't come with me? You don't know I am the king? I'll kill you. And the man burst into laughter saying, there is no greater lie that I heard in life. You can kill me. Me whom the air cannot dry, whom the sword cannot cut, whom the water cannot wet. You can kill my body but not me. He was referring to the self within. And this self is what actually we are searching for in different ways. In different ways. So this journey has come to this situation where the rishi is praying. This is the first step is that he is praying. That, oh Lord, please remove all glitter from you. Glitter. Gold is that which, you know, glitters. We know that. Anything that glitters is actually gold. So he says, remove this glitter from you. He's very careful. He has used the word gold. He has not used any other metal's name. Why? Because in gold, there is this kind of attractiveness. That yellow metal is so very powerful. It attracts. And of course today we know it in a much better way. This attractiveness is not in terms of that just metal. In the Patanjali Yoga Sutras it comes that when a seeker, a sadhaka is proceeding towards the goal of yoga, he is tempted by the nature with capital N, Prakriti. With many powers, miraculous powers, super sensuous powers. He may develop the power of hearing something which is very distant, or he can see a distant thing, or he can become so light, he can perhaps pass through a solid thing like a wall. He develops these powers. Why? Sages, Patanjali says, because these are all Prakriti's way of preventing him to know his real self. Because this is a glitter. This is a glitter which it is speaking of here. The story is told that king once in a kingdom, he wanted to select his successor. So he made some kind of announcement that with these qualifications or these particular qualities, when people, so many people should reach, meet me on this time, then I will select among them. It said that some few people were selected, some 100 of them, and they were to go and meet the king. The day was fixed after a month. Meanwhile, king ordered something. As they were to come, they were to start from a particular spot and reach the palace. On the way, he had thrown open a huge fair, a market, with all kinds of entertainments and attractive eatables and things to buy, sometimes things being given free. It was so very tempting and gripping. Except one, everybody got lost there and did not reach the palace on the time that was specified. And when he reached, the person who reached, king said, "You are the fittest man." He could overcome his temptations, which others were lost into. So like that, we have been given these temptations. And the seeker is saying that, please remove that golden disc from your mouth, your face. Don't tempt me. Do not try to trap me. I am your child. Tattvam pushan apavrano satya dharma yadrishtaye. I want to see the satya dharma. It's a prayer. It's a prayer. Like children sometimes pray, please tell me what is this. And seeing his intense sense of sincerity, the elders, they say, yes, don't worry. This is only a, I suppose he is frightened by a big effigy of a lion. He said, don't worry, it's only an effigy, it is not a real lion. They give him consolation. Same way. And this is the first part is a prayer. The accompanying second verse is also very important, because that prayer gets fulfilled in the second verse. Second verse, again, is a reference to Surya or sun as the symbol of divinity. The verse says, Pushanne karsha yama surya prajapatya vyuha rashmin samuha tejaha yatte rupam kalyanatamam yatte pashyami tatte pashyami yasavasau purushaha sohamasmi. First he began his journey by what we call as perceiving reality different from himself. At the end of the journey, he found that the reality which he thought was different from him is he himself. Now, this is a great journey, so to say. There is a Sufi story that the beloved sat inside the room, and the other beloved came and knocked at the door. Inside, he asked him, "Who is it?" He referred to something, "I am so and so." The door did not open. He returned. Again, he gave a knock and said, "Who is it?" He said, "I am so and so." He went on giving so many descriptions of himself, and every description is a limitation. The door did not open, and finally, when he said, "I am you," then the door opened. This is what is being said in this verse. The meaning of the verse is, O nourisher, Pushan, Ekarshe, solitary traveler, Yama, that is guide or controller, Surya, O sun, Prajapatya, son of Prajapati, Vyuharashmin Samohateja, please gather your rays, withdraw your light. Yatte rupam kalyanatamam tatte pashyami. I want to see your most beautiful form. Yo savasau purushaha sohamasmi. There is that purusha within you, and I am that purusha. Same Sufi story you find. I am that. I always thought I was different from the reality. I always thought reality was different in terms of space. It was located somewhere else. God, he must be in the temple. He may be in the mutt, not here, in my house. Or God is in some other pradesham, desha. Or God is in different loka, or a different time. Not now. God will be seen future, not now. Or causation, different circumstances, time, space and causation. But when these three are dropped, he says, Sohamasmi, I am that. Remove this, I am that. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, as long as a man is ignorant, he thinks reality is there. When he becomes a man of knowledge, he says, reality is here. As long as it is there, it is far off. Even in our day-to-day life, very often we think the cause of our suffering is outside somewhere. Swamiji in his lecture in Karma Yoga, he says, many times we think happiness and unhappiness is caused by others. We forget that it is we who are playing a role. We are participating in the process of our happiness and unhappiness. We are also playing a role in our happiness and unhappiness. If this role was not there, then we would be completely at the mercy of external events. But we are not. We have certain things we learn from others. So for example, somebody, and it's a common problem, feels insulted that he has not been shown due respect. Now, if we are not analyzing from the viewpoint whether the system should be like that, or society should be like that. Well, in society there should be certain principle of respecting and giving due what a person requires or he deserves. But not that. From the personal angle, extremely personal angle, if a person feels insulted, he has agreed to get insulted. He has consented, yes, I am insulted. A child, for example, may not feel insulted in the same way as you are feeling. You have learnt it through various techniques called socialization. Different cultural paradigms, we have learnt it. This is called insult. Suppose you remove that. Or you remove your own personal likes and dislikes. You see from the angle of the person who is insulting. See, he is insulting because that is what he perceives about me. Not what I am, but what he perceives about me. He perceives me as something fit to be insulted. It doesn't mean that I am so. He thinks that he is fit to be spoken harshly, fit to be not treated with respect. It is his view. This is not tattvam, it is only matam. It's one opinion. The matam keeps changing. Same tattvam will be seen in a different way by somebody else. He may say, oh, he is worthy of my respect. He is worthy of all my admiration and adoration. And then the love from within burst forth. There's the first step towards love, and in fact that is the one thing which always is there in love, that is admiration. There is a continuing admiration for the person or the object or whatever we love for. So this discovery is such a remarkable deep truth. Pushan means supporter. Here sun is taken as the symbol of God. You see, just forget all the images that we have in our tradition, in the Sanatana Dharma or outside. For time being, for the sake of an understanding, say we don't have any image. There is no image of any god or goddess. There are no temples. They say in Upanishadic time there were no temples. The temples came much later. So they are searching for a symbol, an image, a pratika, which can convey to them the idea of God. See, what God is, we do not know, but we have an idea. He can be like that. He may be like that. So the most immediate symbol that was available to them and naturally available to them was, and it is still, sun, Surya. It's the most nearest symbol available. We don't have to create. We don't go to have to an idol maker to make an image. It's already there, Surya. And he was known as the supporter of life. Pushan means one who supports life. Without sun, there is no life on earth. So he is the most immediate symbol of God. He is a nourisher. He is a solitary traveler. There is nobody with Surya to travel. He is alone. And he is the one which controls us, Yama. Surya is called Yama also, because our day and night is what our life is, and day and night is completely dependent on Surya. If there is no Surya, there is no day and there is no night. There is something which you do not know how to describe. So our life is totally dependent on sun. We say sun is rising, now sun has set, it is evening. Sun has set, it's not really set. Earth has turned this way, so it's not visible. But in our sensory perception, we say sun has set. It went to the Marina Beach, down into the sea. It really did not go, but for us, if we don't know any other scientific fact, we say it is so. So the sun has made our life. Then the night begins, and our night routine begins. People have to do a little puja in the evening. That's one routine. Or they have to take dinner. The word dinner comes when there is night. And night is there because the sun is not there. The whole life is totally regulated by the presence of sun. Not only this way, even otherwise it is said, it is the sun that we eat. What we eat essentially is sun ray. The primary food product comes from the vegetation, and the vegetation makes its food through sun rays. The photosynthesis takes place and it manufactures its food. And that food becomes the first step in the food chain. And that is eaten by the next, by the next, by the next, till we also eat and it becomes a part of a food cycle. So say it is a sun which is at the core of this whole thing. So he is called Yama. Yama means controller, guide. And he is the son of Prajapati, which means the son of the creator. And he is saying, don't dazzle me. Please gather your rays. Sometimes if you find dazzling taking place, somebody brings a torch and puts it on our eyes. Or if you are driving, there are so much harsh light in front, you say, what is this? I can't see clearly. The same way he says, now please remove this dazzling. Vyuharashmin samuha tejaha. Please remove the dazzling effect. Sri Ramakrishna gives the example of that there is, in the olden days, there were people who will inspect the railway track, and they will have a type of lamp, I think it is still in use, where the light is visible and he is holding it in his hand, which is hanging down near his legs. And light is visible only outside. It's not spreading on all sides. There is a mouth of that box-like structure he is holding with a handle. And that is spread on the railway track. Or whatever area he wants to focus on. And he comes from a distance, you think as if some light is coming. But actually it's not light, it's a person who is coming, he's holding the light. And he comes and asks you, he talks to you, but you do not know who he is. So you request him, "Sir, I want to see your face." There is no other light, remember. There is no other street light or anything around. So he lifts the lantern or the light that he has and puts it on his face. "Oh, this is what you are. You are my old friend." You might recognize him. So same way Sri Ramakrishna said, "It's God. He is holding this light, the light of life. But we don't see him. So we have to pray to him, "Oh Lord, please reveal yourself to me. Put this light on yourself. You are hiding behind everything. Behind all that is happening in this world." The sages tell us, the scriptures repeatedly say this, it is a God who is the power behind. It's like that man who is holding that light. He is holding the light, he is managing, but he is not visible. Likewise, there is that power which is doing everything, but he is not visible. Whether he or she or it or something beyond, we do not know how to describe it, not visible. So this sage is saying, please turn that light towards yourself. He is saying in a different way, he says, remove the dazzle. Let me see your face. Please gather your rays and withdraw your light. I want to see your beautiful form. Yatte rupam kalyanatamam tatte pashyami. It is a beautiful form. It's not just a beautiful form. It is very auspicious form. Kalyanatamam means very auspicious. Lord's form is auspicious form. It purifies the one who sees it. And then when he sees that light, when he sees that light of or the face or that form of the Lord, he says, "Oh, yo savasau purushaha sohamasmi." It is I who am like this. It is I myself who had been holding the light. It is I who had taken the shape of all these. Aham Brahmasmi is the one statement which is made. Or you find in the Purusha Sukta, Vedahametam Purusham Mahantam Aditya Varnah Tamasah Parastat Tameva Viditva Atimrityumeti Nanyah Panta Ayanaya Vidyate. Which means, he has making that statement, "Oh yes, this is me, this is I am. What I thought God is I am." This is not a single small I that we are generally acquainted with. It's not the ego principle that is being spoken of. Ego which is always having a predicate. Ego which is connected with so many things. Ego in its purest form, without any predicates, is being spoken of. You ask a person, he will immediately say, if you ask him, "Who are you?" he will immediately give an answer, "I am this, idam. I am a driver, or I am a speaker, or I am a professor." He always speaks in terms of something. But I am, what I am, that is very difficult to know. Unless a person's mind has become refined, pure, chitta shuddhi takes place. That purity of mind reveals to him his real nature. And here the seeker has that purity of mind. That is why he says, yo sa vasau purusha. Oh, this purusha which I was searching for. Soham asmi. I am that only. I was searching for the purusha. Purusha means puri shayate iti purusha. One who is living in all beings. Beings are called puris. Puri means a small colony. That colonies, these are all colonies. Navadware pure dehi. It is like each one having, is like in a system, each living being. In those puris, one who lives. Who lives? God lives. That's why he is called Purusha. That Parama Purusha. That Parama Purusha, or the Purusha which is the sum total of all Purushas, and Purusha, no gender is meant here. It is meant the living being. So that Purusha Sohamasmi. It is self-realization. I am that. I am what I was searching for. So these two verses we find a very fine blend of approach of Dvaita as well as Advaita. In Dvaita we have this so much of prayer. Oh Lord, please reveal your face to me. Remove this this golden disc. Is prayer. And once he removes, he says, now you remove all this light, so much light, it is disturbing my vision. Once he does it, he says, oh, it is I only. Sohamasmi. It is said a story of a musk deer. The musk deer has got tremendous fragrance from the musk from the which is formed in its navel. They say there is a musk deer's young one was going through this process. So there was a strong fragrance coming. When the fragrance comes, the deer runs for searching its source. So he's saying, I am getting some fragrance. Now how will the mother explain? He is not able to explain, understand. Then finally, after a lot of struggle, he finds the source of that fragrance is me. Then he bursts into a kind of a declaration. Oh, it is me, it is me, it is me. The same way he says, Sohamasmi, Sohamasmi. Oh, I am that. I was searching it outside. I thought some X material will fulfill me. Attainment of some X achievement will make me complete. I tried in so many ways. I tried to see my face, as Swamiji says in the Jnana Yoga lectures. I tried to see my face in different mirrors. I went on searching myself in different reflections, but nowhere I found a complete reflection. I tried to find it in money, I tried to find it in the property, I want to find hundreds of things, there's no ending of this list. Till I stopped looking for the reflection. And then when I discovered that what I was searching outside, I already have. So this is what the Upanishad is teaching us, is bringing before us, that Vyuharashmin Samuha Yatte Rupam Kalyanatamam Tatte Pashyami Yo Savasau Purusho Sohamasmi. Now this is the end of, so to say, of sadhana. The last one more verse we have, and there he is speaking of when he is departing from the world, how he should depart. We shall discuss in the next class. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.